based on facts. So what is the state of Main Street? Basically, Main Street is in a building year. As the effects of the pandemic are waning, we're seeing that local governments are working to both rebuild, replenish resources and other things that they used up during the pandemic, and also prepare for future challenges. So what does that look like? And so what we'll have at the end of this is a set of recommendations, what we learned, not only from our data, but from the listening sessions we conducted, where we had over 100 people participate and give us their feedback on what the numbers mean in their community. So with that, we can go right on in to two of our experts. We're going to be having our senior researchers, Christy John and John Jernberg, who will be walking through the data and getting right into it. So with that, I will turn it over to you, Ms. John.
Thank you, Auditor Blaha. Can you hear me?
You bet.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you all for joining us this morning for the 2024 State of Main Street web event. The information presented this year for cities and counties is budget data for 2024 and revised budget data for 2023. The information is self-reported by cities and counties. It's unaudited data, and cities and counties are required by law to submit this information to our office by January 31st of each year. Please note that the revenues and expenses of public service enterprises are not included. So we are happy to share that all 87 counties reported their budget information to our office, and we released that report last week. And so it's posted on our website under the Reports and Data Analysis tab. And we will be releasing the city summary budget report soon. And today we will also be discussing actual and adjusted for inflation township revenues, expenses, and debt over a 20-year period, 2003 to 2022. And we are not using the budget data for towns. It's because they are not legally required to submit that information to our office, just like cities and counties. So the figures and all the information that we are using today are posted on our website. It's under the Reports and Data Analysis tab, and when you're on that, please click on the State of Main Street and you will be able to see all this information. And so the first set of data that we will be looking is budgeted revenues. And the three primary sources of budgeted revenues displayed on these two charts are taxes, intergovernmental revenues that includes federal, state, county and other local unit grants, and all other revenues. That includes special assessments, license and permits, charges for services, fines and forfeits, interest on investments, and all other revenue sources. And the yellow on the chart is for 2023 revised numbers, and the blue on the chart is for 2024 budgeted numbers. And as you can see, the top chart, it's the 2023 and 2024 county budgeted revenues. And for taxes, there is a 6% increase from 2023 to 2024. Intergovernmental revenues, 22% increase. And for all other revenues, you see a decrease of 6% from 2023 to 2024. And the bottom chart shows the 2023 to 2024 city budgeted revenues for taxes. There is a 9% increase for intergovernmental revenues also. There's a 9% increase from 2023 to 2024. And for all other revenues, it's a 3% increase from 2023 to 2024. And this is for city budgeted revenues. So if you move to the next slide, you can see that we have four figures there, and this shows the county and the city revenue sources as a percent of total revenues, and the blue color represent taxes, orange intergovernmental revenues, and green is all other revenues. The top two charts, the one on the right and the left, is the 2023 and 2024 county revenue sources as a percent of total revenues. And as you can see that for counties, the percent of total revenues derived from taxes and all other revenues decrease, while it increased for intergovernmental revenues. That is the top two charts. The bottom two charts is the 2023 and 2024 city revenue sources as a percent of total revenues. If you look at those two charts, you can see that for cities, the percent of total budgeted revenues derived from taxes, intergovernmental revenues, and all other revenues remain the same. And if you go to the next slide, you can see that we have two charts there, and this shows the county and the city revenue sources percentage change. And if it's blue, that means it's an increase, and the decreases are displayed in red. The top chart shows the 2023 to 2024 county revenue source percentage change, and the largest increases are seen in grants, from counties and other local units. The second is interest on investments, and the third category is state general purpose aid. The bottom chart shows the 2023 to 2024 city revenue source percentage change, and the largest increases are seen for investments. All other taxes that include local sales, franchise, hotel, motel, gambling, and gravel taxes. And the third category, the main category, is state general purpose aid. Now we move to the next slide. We are going to look at the next set of data, that is budgeted expenses. The three primary categories of budget expenditures displayed on these two charts are current expenditures, capital outlay, and debt service. And the yellow on the chart is for 2023 revised numbers, and the blue on the chart is for 2024 budgeted numbers. The top chart shows the 2023 and 2024 county budgeted expenses. And for current expenditures, there was a 9% increase from 2023 to 2024. Capital outlay also 9% increase, and debt service, we see a decrease of 23% from 2023 to 2024, that is for counties. If you look at the bottom chart, is the 2023 and 2024 city budgeted budgeted expenditures. It's the current expenditures, you see a 3% increase, capital outlay 11% increase, and debt service, it's a 2% increase if you look at the 2023 to 2024 city budgeted expenditures. So we move to the next slide. We have four figures there, and this represents city, county, and city budgeted expenditures by primary type as a percent of total expenditures. The four charts, if you look at the four charts, the current expenditures are displayed in blue color, capital outlay in orange, and debt service in green. The top two charts, one on the right and one on the left, is the 2023 and 2024 county expenditures by primary type as a percent of total expenditures. If you look at counties, the percent of total budgeted expenditures increased slightly for current expenditures. Capital outlay, it remained the same. And while if you look at debt service, it decreased slightly if you look at the 2023 and 2024 counties. The bottom two charts, it's 2023 and 2024 city expenditures by type. And if you look at the cities, the percent of total budget expenditures decreased slightly for current expenditures, while capital outlay and debt service remain the same from 2023 to 2024. And so if we move to the next slide, we have two charts there, and it displays the change between the 2023 and 2024 major expenditure categories for county and city budget expenses. The blue on the graph shows when there is an increase from 2023 to 2024, and the red shows a decrease. The top chart shows the 2023 to 2024 county expenditures percentage change. The largest increases include streets and highways capital outlay, followed by current expenditures for general government, and also the current expenditures for health. And the bottom chart shows the 2023 to 2024 city expenditures percentage change. The largest increases are seen in current expenditures for human services, followed by current expenditures for conservation of natural resources and all other capital outlay. Now we will look at the township data. For that, we will go to John Jenberg.
Good morning, and thank you, Christy, and thank you, Auditor Blaha. Again, looking at the township data, this is actual and adjusted for inflation information because townships are not required by law to submit budget data to our office. So we took a 20-year look at the data for revenues, expenditures, and debt, and that's what we'll be looking at the final sets of slides here. As we look at the top figure, it shows the two primary township revenue sources, which are property taxes and intergovernmental revenues as a percentage of total revenues over the 20-year period. The percentage of total township revenues derived from intergovernmental revenues has increased over the past 20 years, and that's the orange, that is the orange line on the bottom. And the percentage of total revenues from property taxes has decreased over this time. And that is the blue line at the top. The bottom figure shows township revenues in both actual, which is the blue line, and adjusted for inflation, which is the orange line. The chart shows that when adjusted for inflation, township revenues have increased over the past 20 years. As we go to the next slide, figures 19 and 20 show township expenditures for the 20-year period. The top slide shows the top three expenditure categories as a percentage of total expenditures. The top three expenditure categories include road and bridge, which is the orange or top line, general government, which is the blue or middle line, and fire, which is the green or bottom line. This figure shows that the road and bridge category has increased and is a greater proportion of total expenditures for the townships over the 20-year period, whereas general government and fire categories have stayed relatively consistent. The bottom figure shows the change in total township expenditures between 2003 and 2020 and 2022. When adjusted for inflation, township expenditures has increased over this period for both the constant dollars and the actual. The next slide, figure 21 and 22, show outstanding debt as a percentage of total revenues for the past 20 years. You can see that outstanding debt has decreased as a percentage of total revenues over the 20-year period. The bottom figure shows town aid also as a percentage of total revenues from its inception in 2014 through 2022. As you can see, town aid as a percentage of total revenues has decreased over this period. The town aid allocation was capped at $10 million over this period. That concludes the presentation of the data, and now we will bring it back to Auditor Blaha.
Thank you, John and Christy. I've been told I need to talk a little bit louder, so just a heads up, anybody in the room, I need to face the right direction and talk a little louder. So let's see if this works out a little better for us. So when it comes right down to what does this all mean? We have heard a lot on our listening tour. We heard a lot about the challenges on the horizon, an unpredictable weather patterns to go from all the snow to no snow, for instance, over the last couple of years. Talking about aging populations came up quite a bit, and that may show up in different ways. It might show up in housing shortages, might show up in an increased need on an already stretched thin ambulance service. And so to handle these upcoming challenges, it's tempting to think, let's just keep building up those reserves at the expense of infrastructure or the other way. What we're suggesting is that a balance is going to be needed. What we've learned during the pandemic was that it wasn't just reserves that were helpful, it was already existing infrastructure. Those reserves didn't go as far if you had to start rebuilding something from zero, whether that be a physical structure, whether that be programs, whether that be relationships. That infrastructure is something that made any resources you had socked away go a lot farther. So the idea is, let's make hay while the sun shines. At this time, in a period of relative calm compared to recent history, this is a really good time to both build reserves and also refresh and rebuild infrastructure as well. So with that, these numbers only mean so much as graphs, but we need to add some actual stories to this. And so what we have on hand, we have five people who are from around the state who offered to give us their take on that. Now, I'm going to give you the order for those of you who are online ready to come in. We have one person here in person, and we'll have the rest will be here virtually. And so this is the order you're going in. We're going to start with Jim Checkle from Ashland Township Supervisor. Then we're going to Mary Jo McGuire, who's our Ramsey County Commissioner and past president of the Association of Minnesota Counties. And then we'll go to Madeline Mitchell, City of St. Paul Budget Manager. And then Kathleen Ryan, Aiken County Chief Financial Officer. And then Sheila Marie Antai, Stillwater Township Chair. So with that, let me turn it over to Jim. And again, yell at that camera. That should work there. Go ahead.
Well, good morning, everyone. I'm Jim Checkle from Ashland Township in Dodge County, Minnesota. And I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to speak to this group for an hour today. So what we've been seeing in Ashland Township is three major things that are causing us to have to increase our levy. One is the increased cost of road maintenance. The other one is the increased cost of the health that we have come and the para that we have to also include in that payment. And another thing that we have is the cost for ambulance services. And so I'd like to talk a little bit more, focus more on the ambulance service thing and what we're doing in Dodge County. And so I would encourage all of you, if you haven't talked with your ambulance services or with your counties about the ambulance service, to find out what their costs are, what their expenses are, because around the state and around the nation, ambulance services are struggling. And in the next few years, several of them may no longer exist, will merge with other services. And so what we've done in Dodge County is we have taken and we've looked at what it's going to cost to maintain our ambulance services, and it averages out to about $60 a resident increase. So the cities have established a committee or a task force so that they can levy $60 tax on the property taxes on the people in the, that live in the cities. We can't do that as a township, so what we've done is we've asked our voters to give us a $60 increase, which ended up being about a 16% increase in our budget, which is the most we've ever asked for. And so what we've done now is the money will come to the township at $60 per resident. That money will then be set aside to be used to support our ambulance.
Thank you so much, Jim. All right. Well, let's keep going. Let's take this now Mary Jo McGuire, Ramsey County Commissioner and AMC past president. Let's go from a township to a very large county.
Thank you. Thank you, Auditor Blaha. Can you hear me now? Is this good? All right. Well, first of all, thank you, Auditor Blaha, for doing these listening sessions around the state and for putting them on Zoom so that everyone can really appreciate and see these numbers. We so appreciate working with you and all of the data that you're doing. And just to thank our presenters and shout out to John Jernberg, my former neighbor, who I love to always hear talk. So anyway, but I'm excited to be here to talk about the impact that we've seen in the budget these days in county government. And since I am involved with our State Association of Counties, you know, we can say that these trends are generally universally felt by all counties in the states. Of course, the bigger ones feel them in large monetary amounts and the smaller ones in smaller, but they all are impacted by what's going on in the state and federal government, really. So the trends are what we do see tracking with our experience. I think most counties have had to increase their property taxes and take advantage of other state and federal revenue sources. We always have to look to all revenue sources to do the work that we do. It's the only way that counties can raise resources is with the property tax if we don't get state and federal dollars and if we don't get grant money as well. So we continue to see a high demand for services. And, you know, the pandemic, of course, was super high, but we that hasn't necessarily gone down. And the resources that we got during the pandemic, which were much needed and helped transform the work that we do, they really just started to address the work that we have to do. We were really falling behind in addressing homelessness, transportation, you know, violence prevention, you know, all the work that counties do. We needed to have these resources, and we were just starting to address those gaps. And then some of those dollars have gone away now, and so we're needing to continue to rely on our state and federal partners. And then, of course, we have to rely on property taxes. I love that you said when it's we have to make hay when the sun shines. I used to say that, you know, when it's, we have a rainy day fund, which is our budget, you know, our reserves. And when it was raining, we said we got to use it. But when it's not raining, we got to invest then when it's not raining. We can't like just give the money back. We got to invest in our infrastructure. We have to invest in what we're all doing so that we can be ready for the next time when it rains and when we really need those reserves. So I just want to say how grateful we are that that we have these partnerships with you, with our cities, with our townships, with our federal government. We can't do this work alone, and we need to continue to work together.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mary Jo. Let's now go to, let's stay in Ramsey County, and let's get, let's hear from Madeline Mitchell, the City of St. Paul Budget Manager.
Hey, good morning. Thank you, Auditor Blaha and team, for inviting me today. It's really great to be here to hear the results of this analysis and to hear from other local governments. So in St. Paul, like many other cities, our primary general fund expense is our people. Employees make up nearly 80% of our general fund budget. So what this has meant for us is that changes in the labor market can have a really, really big impact on our budget. In recent years, cities have been adapting to inflationary increases to contracts and health insurance costs. And due to a really tight labor market that we've all experienced, we've often needed to make offers that are higher on the salary schedule just to stay competitive. So these pressures combined with revenue that doesn't grow very much automatically mean that we really rely on property taxes and local government aid to balance our general fund budget and to maintain that service delivery. So data set 3, I think it was, showed the relationship between intergovernmental revenue and property taxes for townships. And while we are not a township, we have a very similar graph that shows the historical relationship between property taxes and LGA in St. Paul. And as LGA levels fell or did not increase with inflation, the city had to backfill that support with property taxes. So where LGA once made up 42% of our general fund revenues and property taxes were under 25%, LGA now makes up just over 20%, and property taxes are over 45% of our general fund revenues. So they've totally switched. So our graph and the graph in data set 3 do really highlight how LGA is property tax relief. The 2024 boost in the allocation that we saw was really critical to St. Paul's ability to keep the levy growth modest. For us, it was 3.7%. To maintain the budgeted services without this increase, we would have had to raise the levy by an additional 4.5%. So we're really grateful to the legislators who championed this. It is really crucial for us to be able to provide city services here in the capital city. This boost was a huge win for cities, and we'd really love to see this program fully funded and pegged to inflation in the future. And I would just end by saying I second what was said earlier, that it's great to work together, and I hope we can continue to collaborate on LGA and other issues that are impacting local governments. Thank you.
All right. That's, again, these are, I really appreciate all these presenters. It's always fun when you're one of the, you get further down the list. I see what to add new, but we're going to go to Kathleen Ryan. So let's go out to Aitkin County and hear from their chief financial officer. Kathleen.
Good morning. Thanks for having us from Aitkin. Myself, Kathleen Ryan. I'm the CFO. I have Kirk Pazer with me. He's the auditor for Aitkin County also. We really appreciate to participate.
Can I just check in and check on your camera? Is your camera on or are you? Because we can hear you great.
Oh, yeah, I can see myself, but
that's fine. That happens every so often on this. Well, I'll tell you what, you sound amazing and you probably look good on YouTube. So with that, I'll let you keep going.
Oh, sorry. Well, we just want to say that the increase in county program aid, the corrections funding and the PILT funding really made a significant difference in our budget for 2024. For multiple years now, we've had to budget a large amount of fund balance in order to balance our budget. And with the increased funding that we received, we were able to budget our 2024 budget with only planned use of fund balance that we wanted to use. So that was huge for us. It allowed us to keep our levy increase low, and not only to ease the burden of our taxpayers, but it also allows us to allocate resources efficiently towards our vital services that we need for infrastructure improvements and other services in the county. This was great progress for us, and while we celebrate that, there is still the ongoing challenge of unfunded mandates that come down from the state. And these mandates are a struggle for the county. They strain our financial resources and cause staffing issues because our workforce is trying to keep up with these mandates. And so it's increased workload and such. So that continues to cause issues for the county and the budget. Looking forward to 2025 budget, some of the driving factors are inflation, the skyrocketing cost of road maintenance materials and equipment. We see that as an issue coming forward to us. The other areas of concern that we're looking at are jail medical costs that continue to rise, staffing, not only retaining staff, but trying to pay competitive wages and keep them in our within budget. And the HR mandates, like the earned sick and safe time, causes additional, again, strain on our workforce to manage those. Some other concerns coming forward are changes in the utility taxing that Minnesota Department of Revenue is looking at. That concerns us if that continues to move forward. And of course, the forfeited property legislation as that moves forward and the settlements that might, you know, how that's going to come forward and what the state support for counties will be. So those are some of the large concerns that are we're looking forward to in the future, and hope that counties will continue to have support from the state on.
Oh, thank you so much. Well, this is great. Let's bring it home and finish up with Sheila Marie Antite from Stillwater Township Chair. Not only is she chair in Stillwater Township, but she also is the only person who's been on every single one of our State of Main Street analyses. So she enters the Five Timers Club today. And so with that, Sheila Marie.
Is there a prize?
You know what? It's the honor, because of course, as your state auditor, I'm not going to give you anything over de minimis value.
Okay, I am the chair of Stillwater Township. I've been on the board for 29 years. We have an unusual situation in that we're an urban township, so we're north of Stillwater. We have been annexed once, part of our community. Rochester Township has the exact same issue. They've got property and the city's growing. We have no commercial zoning. Only 3% of our income comes from intergovernmental funds. 97% of our income is property tax. So if we have a levy, it's a big hit on our residents. Our three areas that we spend money on is fire service, which is contracted from the city of Stillwater. We have a three-year contract. It's coming up this year. I expect it to jump 10%. It does every time. And legitimately so. I mean, they have expenses too. Roads and bridges. We have $1,625,000 in the bank in CDs. We include in our levy $250,000 every year to put into our road and bridge fund so that we are self-funded. We have a 25-year schedule with projections, with inflation built in. So we have no debt, and we don't want to levy, or not to levy, to bond. So we try really hard to stay ahead of that. Our plowing, we budget on a 10-year rolling average. This year, of course, we came out ahead. Last year, we came out behind. All of our services are contracted. We do have W-2 employees, which are all part-time, which goes to the previous speaker, Brooke, brought up the sick and safe program. That cost us $11,000 for part-time employees that have the ability to control their own schedules. I mean, that was just, I don't think that was a good program, or it wasn't constructed well. I understand people need to be able to be sick, but that was just an interesting thing that cost us $11,000. Our COVID funds, we received $150,000. We've initially used $900 for our election for PPE. We had no need for that money. It was just sent to us. I also kind of questioned that program, but so as it rolled out and changed, we used $6,500 to contribute to an application with Comcast for broadband, and that we did receive $11 million grant that was partly Comcast money, partly federal money, partly state money, partly county money. So because I personally have a download speed of 0.5, and a lot of people in our community have no Wi-Fi, or literally have very, very slow Wi-Fi. People can't work at home, and that affects their property value. We also use some of the funds to put in a new furnace with an air exchange unit. We added security cameras to our property, and a remote locking system so that residents like homeowners associations can use our building without staff having to be there. Our clerk can let them in and lock it up after they leave remotely. So that's been able to give access to the community to use our building for public meetings, but also private meetings. So that's us.
Thank you so much. And you know what? Let's give a round of applause to our speakers here. I'm actually not alone in this room. And so as we go into our point for discussion, yeah, go ahead, why don't you zoom out? We're gonna got this really cool zoomy camera. And so we're gonna try making a cool transition over to this space. All right, so I do want to welcome, we have about, 23, 24, I haven't counted recently, of a township folk who are here with the Minnesota Association of Townships. And so they were able to stop by before their work for the next couple of days in here. And so with that, I just want to ask, you know, if there are other people have reactions or questions. Again, I'm watching the chat here and we have people in the room. And maybe I'll start, maybe throw it to the room here. You know, we had some interesting discussions before we walked in. And I'm trying to learn that I'm supposed to yell at this camera. So I'm trying to face, so I'm going to do that cheating thing they do on the TV. And so maybe if there are other people who wanted to, you know, add to that or react to it, what's happening in your community that you're noticing? I'm going to go right over here. I'm just going to point right to you because you have great stuff. And also during our listening sessions.
Well, as Jim noted earlier, the cost of maintaining roads has gone up. The gas tax is actually going down because of the higher efficiency cars and that type of stuff. And it's creating a gap in how we can afford to maintain our roads. The other problem we're running into, especially in the rural area, is a lot of your farmers now are driving semi-trucks instead of the old little single-axle, trailers or whatever stuff. So there's a lot more pressure put on them roads. They need to look at finding out ways to get more money to us to maintain these roads.
Yeah, other thoughts? Again, watching the thing. And again, panelists too, if you want to hop in, you can just start talking and I should be able to catch you that way. But yeah, again, add that.
We got an issue going on right now in our township where we have a road that's slowly being washed out by the Crow River. 2 years ago, we recommended to the FEMA and Corps of Engineers and the county on how to fix it. Well, they had their own way of fixing it, and it didn't even last. They fixed it. They threw a bunch of dead stumps in there and throw some mud in there. I mean, it didn't even last 6 months. Now we had to pay some of it, but now they want to redo it, but they want the township to pay for the whole thing. That's a pretty good chunk of money out of our budget.
Well, you know, I think you bring up a really good concept. Something we talk about a lot is about how do groups work together. You know, one of the things that we've recommended from year to year is that maintaining, for instance, ongoing funding so you don't get surprises and things that avoid surprises. So not having funding, people say, oh, hey, everybody's doing great, we'll pull the money back. But have something you can actually count on. When you think about ways that you kind of intersect with state or federal government, are there other things, other ideas you have for, as we send this off to all of our partners, what you wish other levels of government knew? Again, along the lines of Corps of Engineers, if you make a bold choice, you should pay for a bold choice, or something like that. What else? And I think unfunded mandates have come up, but there are ideas. Yeah.
Going along with the with heavier trucks and stuff on the township roads, these current bridges and culverts that we've had in our townships were not built for that. And so they're getting deficient. And unfortunately, the replacement cycle of trying to get them replaced is falling farther and farther behind.
You know, that's the thing about where we are on infrastructure. And we talked about during COVID, we really noticed that we had a dip. Right, that during tough times, that COVID hit about when some of the delayed infrastructure choices kind of hit from the recession, and the idea of them kind of piling on top of each other. So where are you? Where do you guys all feel like you are? And I'm actually going to throw it to our panelists too. Maybe I'll start with Mary Jo, since your camera's up, and put you on the spot. When you talk about where you are in infrastructure, do you feel like you're in a good spot? You guys are catching up. You're ahead of the game. Where do you feel like you are?
Well, thanks. Thanks, Auditor Blaha. And I just really appreciate the panel being there. We really need to work with our townships. Counties need to work with our townships. And I'll put a plug in for our Big Four, which is a group of the executive boards of the cities, the counties, the townships, and the school boards. And we get together, you know, four times a year, and we talk about the issues that we come together on. And definitely infrastructure is one of them. We all need greater partnership with our state and federal government on our infrastructure. We all are working as hard as we can to keep our roads and bridges, you know, functioning. And we all have the larger vehicles, and you know, we that are using our roads. So we know that we need to keep those partnerships going. That we need to keep working with our legislators to let them know that if they want us to do this work, if we are there, as we are their partner, we're not a lobbying group. We're their partner, and we need to get their help to do this work. We're finding counties all over the state are having the same issues with infrastructure as the townships are, as the cities are, and we all need to work together to help our legislators understand that if they want us to do something, we need their support to help pay for it. I couldn't agree more with the unfunded mandates, you know, and we just need to keep impressing upon them the importance that we need those dollars and consistent funding. The up and down is just not feasible for all of us. We need to know, you know, in those formulas, we need those formulas to move with inflation. You know, we can't just keep getting the same amount. We need those amounts to be increased. So it's, yeah, we're totally in all allies in this work.
That's usually, if I want to get agreement, we can talk about that's usually one place. Jim, I think you also had an idea.
So one of the things that we're seeing in Dodge County, and I don't know if other counties are seeing this or not, but the county is turning back roads to the townships. And so our amount of roads that we have right now, we've got about 37 miles. We're going to have about 41 miles of road. And so we're going to be gaining. Part of this is because Highway 14 expanded to a 4-lane in Dodge County, and it reverted back to 2-lane to the county. So the county then said, well, we've got more roads. We're not going to fund our lettered roads to the extent that we have been. And so those roads will be going back to the townships. And so we're going to be seeing, you know, eventually we're going to be seeing maybe about a 10% increase in our expenses because of the number of roads and things that we're picking up. And so that's going to be a major hit.
Well, I kind of talk about pushing on the balloon, that concept of the idea of like, if some things you're not going to get rid of, right? You can lower it here, but it's just going to go up somewhere else. You're just going to move it around on that. Oh, wow. Are there, I've got one and then two. Okay.
Yeah. Go right, start up. Yeah. No, I'm up from Cormorant Township, and we're up in the Lakes Country in Becker County. And our situation is that obviously in the summer, our population triples because of all of the Lake people, cities, you know, and then we have people from Bismarck, Fargo, Moorhead, you know, our township roads literally get, you know, triple the use. So what we had to do is actually increase our levy for road and bridge, which we haven't done for 12 years in our township. So that was pretty significant for our little township. But on a positive note, we did apply for the LRIP grant through Minnesota DOT, and we were awarded $300,000 for a road that is like a major artery in the summer around the lakes. And so there, obviously, it's a pain in the butt to apply for these grants, but if you are diligent, you know, we are just thrilled that we were able to get that money. So there are, you know, if you seek for funds, that was an awesome opportunity for us.
That was one of the things that our last State Administrator recommendations were for grantors, to make sure that you made these things available and make sure people actually knew about them as well. And I think, Jeff, did you want to comment there?
Actually, thank you for the segue. That was actually going to be my comment. I have talked with federal as well as our state legislators about grant writing. The difficulty that townships do have, you don't have a professional staff like the bigger cities do, the counties do, and we're all volunteers. And for us to try and do any type of grant writing, especially when it comes to federal grant writing, that's way out of our wheelhouse. And even with the LREP program that we have, you have to have an engineer involved. And so you're spending between $5,000 and $10,000, you know, just to enter this lottery. And I think we had 103 applications last time, and we had 18 winners. So it's a lot of money that townships are spending, and they're seeing no return on that investment, unfortunately. I mean, that's the way the game has been set up, but it can be costly, and that's why a lot of townships don't.
So I've been clerk for our township for about 2 years now. I'm fairly new yet, so I did, this was the last year that I first did the LREP application, and it's great if you can get the money, but I know that our former clerk had applied for it, and we've never gotten any, and I understand that there's only so much that can go around, but as speaking to the cost for it, I didn't realize, you know, going through the process was learning the things that you had to submit with it, all the things that had to go along with it, and getting a hold of our engineer and getting just like an estimate for what it was we were looking for. And part of the problem for townships, I think, is that we're looking to get this grant money, but their projects we're not going to do unless we get the grant money, because we don't necessarily have the budget for it. Whereas these grants are set up for, hey, there's this thing you're going to do and we'll kick in with it for you.
Right.
Whereas what we need is, if it's a one-time grant to upgrade a gravel road to a tar road, that's something we're going to do unless we have the money, because we're not going to increase levies if we don't have to, because that just goes back to our taxpayers. But so I just wanted to make that comment about the LREP.
And I'll just say, I filled out the application the last couple of years too, and we've never gotten it either. So congratulations.
I think everybody's going to hang out and follow you out. Right. See what you did.
But it also sounds like it goes to, if you have a lake or if you have stuff like that, but if it's actually to, you know, widen out a road for housing, or where there's also safety reasons for why we need to do this, we don't get picked for that. But it just seems like it's more resort areas in the township areas that we get kicked out because we don't have a resort in our township.
You know, this really, you know, I feel like I'm looking at my time. I want to make sure I'm good on the time. This is almost a perfect place to wrap, because I think you all brought it back to that idea of how important it is to also have infrastructure. That the idea of how do we help us build infrastructure from the ground up, so we don't, one, so that we're better prepared in a crisis, but also the idea that if grants are built on things that already exist, how do you get into that cycle? It's like, if you have to have stuff to get, you have to have something to get money, but you need money to get something, how do you break that cycle? And that idea of how do we help build infrastructure now so we can break those cycles? Well, I have to say, this has been absolutely tremendous. I so appreciate this. I want to also thank, before we go, the team at our office. We have, of course, the Government Information Division research team, Kathy Doctor, the director, John Schoenberg, and Christy John, who you heard from today. But then we also had everybody who kept this going, so they actually stayed on camera. Megan and Donald and Bert and Maya, and I hope I don't miss anybody else, but I have to tell you what, I want to give a round of applause for the team that helped put this together. So let's hear it for them. Again, from all the panelists and the participants, this is extremely helpful. One more time. And with that, just want to say, hey, we really appreciate you digging into the numbers, and we can't wait to keep working with you and making sure we keep the state of Main Street strong. Thanks, everybody. Have a great day.